So my talk's going to be quite short. There's just one major point I want to make. And it's this. I mean, it's obvious that if you want to see something, you have to have light. Okay? And seeing an object in front of you, you can say, well, it's round, it's squishy, it's got this color. You can sort of notice all of those fairly abstract qualities pretty well, and just about everyone in the world could do that. But if you want to actually figure out what those shapes, colors, and things mean, then that's something very different. You need to rely on cultural information in order to be able to interpret what you see. And art really, there's not much point in having art unless you can get some, derive some kind of meaning, or you can understand something by seeing it. It's very rare for artists to make work just for themselves. There are artists like that, but I'm not one of them. I'm an artist who makes work for other people to look at, and I'm sure most people here are the same sort of way. So, seeing as I've put forward the argument that the interpretation or understanding or enjoyment of art has to do with cultural knowledge, then let us look. Today I want to examine the very specific and unique place that holographic imagery holds in cultural knowledge. Now, for most people in the world, the ontology of a hologram is in fact the computer graphic representations and special effects of holograms in films. That's because people rarely see real holograms. Now, for some artists, recuperating that kind of fictitious origination information is very much the right of the holographic artist to reappropriate the incorrect, you could say on one hand, or it's just another imaginative form of a hologram which computer graphics and the film industry and science fiction industry had about holograms. Martin Richardson has written a marvellous paper documenting all of those instances, and I've also given a paper at Wales on this subject. So here's a work of mine, the master hologram made by Walter Spearings and the shim made by A.J. Langadoc, called The Legend of the True Hologram, and it incorporates the type of iconography that is associated with a hologram to the general public. It has a little princess, it has a ray of light, and it has a kind of a rastering form. And from it, I have The Legend of the True Hologram written in several languages. So the first thing I want to look at is really how do people usually understand art? Because later I'm going to say, within that, I'm going to explain how it works differently for holograms than it does for usual artworks. So there are sort of four main ways in which people are able to understand what art means, unless they know the artist or they are the artist. And that is, they've seen other artworks, they know other artworks in the same genre or the same subject matter, they've seen representations of art in books and on the internet, and they understand the theories and writings surrounding art. Now, these photographs I've taken at the recent Venice Biennale in 2009 of art work that is shown, you know, in 2009. This is sort of how some of the artwork works. And I've chosen examples which in some way sort of slightly peripherally engage with holographic imagery. So let's have the first category, going and actually seeing experiences of artwork. That's how a lot of people get to know if they can understand this work or that work, is because they've already seen another work which is either similar or in the same media. Now, I would argue that because holography is so incredibly different from other media, that seeing light installations and experiences of other media really isn't all of that instructive in terms of being able to understand the very specific type of holographic space. And as Jonathan Ross has pointed out in an earlier paper today, the experience, the direct experience of holographic imagery is is very small, and there are very, very few international exhibitions. So the very first of the 4 points is negated. People don't get to see holographic exhibitions. And the second thing is familiarity with what has already taken place in that media. When we see this video installation work, we're reminded of a whole lot of associated artworks that we've seen in recent wraparound narratives, which are made of fictitious elements combining computer graphics and figures, namely the work of Bill Viola. And this relates also back to classical themes, and we're reminded of post-colonial theorization. So the minute that we see works like this, we already have seen other video images and compositions, and that helps us to understand what we're doing. But of course, with the hologram, because we haven't seen other examples, we don't really know what these things mean. And I think the thing I neglected to mention when I first showed the hologram that I made, called The Legend of the True Hologram, is that it's totally fine if people haven't seen holograms before and they've only seen holograms in films, if you want to make work about that. But if you want to make other kind of artwork and you're a holographic artist, if you're Melissa Crenshaw, for example, who uses all of the most beautiful specific characteristics of the holographic medium, such as three-dimensional shadows which project into the viewer's space, pseudoscopic imagery, I mean, Andy Pepper's shadowgrams, these types of intrinsic holographic phenomena are really very difficult to appreciate. They are part of the rich vocabulary of holographic art, but the general public is just not familiar with them. We are, but they aren't. And the third point is the documentation of art is generally the way in which we learn about art. In Australia, that's the main way we learn about art, because living so far from Europe, we generally only see photographs of imagery until we can afford to come overseas and see the real thing. Now, of course, in the case of perspectival imagery, or imagery which doesn't have a particular necessity to comprehend the spatial dimension, then taking a photograph with a lens is, of course, totally fine. But let's just remember this, that holographic space is nothing like lens-based photography. And the minute you take a photograph of a hologram, you totally transform the space and ruin and destroy the special holographic effects. So therefore, the third factor, the documentation of the artwork, in fact, totally negates some of the most amazing and fantastic features of it. And now let's have the final point, the theorization of art. I think all of us are quite well aware that in the very early days of holography, Jean Baudrillard and Umberto Eco both produced theories which were rather similar in some ways, the simulacra and the hyperreal. And these theories really had to do with the idea that holography was merely a replication of reality. But funnily enough, these theories, which of course were not at all supported by the artwork that was produced at the time, because artists were very much engaged with the specific pictorial qualities of the holographic image. And so when art critics came to actually look at a hologram, they did not in fact see that the predictions of Umberto Eco and Jean Baudrillard had come true, and perhaps that's why critics had to stay away, because there wasn't really a theoretical frame. But something very hilarious about the incredible theoretical frame which surrounds digital media at the moment, and one of the rare contemporary books which mentions holography on digital media, the book by Timothy Murray of Cornell University entitled The Digital Baroque, actually mentions holograms in the context of other light media and media imagery. These arguments all have to do with the kind of the power struggle, the domination of lens-based imagery about perspective. And this image, this artwork here, which really is almost a kind of a manifestation of an enormous a mass of French theorization about the panopticon, about the privilege of a single point of view, about surveillance, which really is a completely different system of space to the holographic image. Now, we have on one hand Baudrillard and Eco saying that a hologram is a simulacra of space, which one would presume actually supports the fact that analog holographic space does not have a specific favored point of view. So you would have thought that the French theory would have embraced the analog hologram as an utterly new method of spatial reconstruction. And as the politics of space is so intimately connected to the freedom of the individual, the way of looking at reality, one would have thought that this argument would have been taken up. But I think really the reality of the situation is it just takes a very long time to actually see what is already there. This is the point that I'm making. That although that real space may have been in a hologram, that in fact, although you could show the hologram to people, that they could look at it, that in fact, because of perspective, because of the domination of the lens, it is actually not that easy to even see something that is before your very eyes. And it's for this reason that these other following suggestions here came to mind after reading a fantastic book by the great art historian Michael Baxendon called something like, but the correct title will be in the paper, is something like Appreciating 15th Century Painting or the 15th Century Eye. And what Michael Baxendale was saying was that in the paintings, in the perspectival paintings of this period, the devices that painters used to enable just any man in the street to understand a painting, because often paintings were used because people couldn't read or write and people wanted to communicate information through the visual imagery, they used a whole lot of different devices that absolutely everyone in the 15th century could do and knew about. So they used dance steps that people used, like they used the intervals of dance steps. They used the proportions and knowledge that people used to choose horses. They used the geometrical models that were used in high school textbooks for measuring the contents of barrels. And so, in other words, all this kind of common stuff that just everybody knew, that you didn't need to be a connoisseur of painting or very knowledgeable in order to really enjoy a painting in the 15th century. So given that it was possible for non-experts to actually interpret the pictorial space of the 15th century by means available to everybody, I started thinking, now what are the parallel sorts of things that are available to everybody so that anybody would find it easier to comprehend a hologram? But of course, as we know from all of the amazing examples of hybrids, of analog holograms, digital holograms, CGH, and all the various permutations, you can't put a blanket over a hologram because they all behave in quite a different way. So the first kind of hologram, holograms with very high resolution, analog holograms, are best suited to, in other words, they often have an analogy to reality as their major point of reference because they have such a high level of verisimilitude, such a high level of reality. I'm showing you this because I'm among family, and this I consider this work to be pretty hopeless. I made it in 1979, and here I am with Professor Jean Viennot, the head of the Laboratoire de Physique et Optique à Besançon, where I was so fortunate to be able to go and learn from wonderful people, Nicole Abichier and Bernard Carqui, who use the pulse laser. Slide's not that good, but there's a face there hanging where the mirror is, and in the hand basin, instead of water, there's a mirror which reflects the light above the hologram mirror and shows a pair of hands washing themselves. But look, this is the first time I used the mirror. So we're looking at the mirror. This is another work. I was happier with this. It was a portrait of this woman, Margaret Carnegie. It was a double exposure. And I used the mirror in a similar way that Velázquez used in the painting of Las Maninas, to reflect the subject outside of the picture. So when you look at Margaret Carnegie's hologram, when you stand where she is now, you realise she's standing right next to you. She's reflected from a mirror within the composition. This work I'm happier with, more recent work, is a hand-embossed rainbow hologram into bronze. The hologram is actually integral into the bronze surface, playing back the message which Didi Jung mentioned this morning about the magic mirror and the actual kind of reinstating in a personal way the holographic technology, obliterating the mirror image rather than being a secret image. The hologram image is there and actually spoils the ability of you to look at yourself in the reflection. So again, this is the reason why a mirror is a very good kind of analogy is that we understand that the edges of mirrors will crop, that the reflection will not go past them. And I often use this as a kind of a language because the picture plane is an important thing to make obvious and definite. And here is a slide showing how if the film was not flat, how it just wouldn't work. This is the film version of the hologram I made for the installation To Absent Friends, which has several laser transmission holograms which replace mirrors in a barroom which show the events of a New Year's Eve party, each mirror reflecting the barroom at a different time. So this is Agfa film. I also recorded all the holograms on Kodak plates which were made specially for me, and for me it was a far better solution because the flatness of the picture plane as a mirror surface was absolutely essential to this work. This work was commissioned by Robert and Janet Holmes Accord. So now I'm going to talk about some of those other things. So that series of works had to do with using the mirror as an analogy. This, I'm starting to suggest that the lighting, the replay lighting of the hologram can sometimes show theatrical kind of effects. This is a photograph of the finished hologram. This is made by Giola, and it's from Computer Graphics. There are two things here which are used. The phenomenology of the actual light field, in other words, the light that you stand in and that you're surrounded by when you see a hologram, is another factor which is very unique to the hologram. I mean, every other work, it's not just a hassle having to have the light in the right place. Having the light in a particular place actually puts light onto the subject or puts light onto the floor or, you know, and a lot of artists have played with this kind of thing. In a transmission hologram that I made for a Catholic church, the light coming through the hologram illuminated the viewer's chest and made the viewer feel very special. So the actual physicality of the replay lighting is rarely acknowledged. But in this work, you can see the kind of ray of light on the figure. This ray of light actually is an image of a ray of light which occurs where the replay lighting shines onto the figure. This composition we heard earlier today about reversal in animation. This animation begins with a light figure on a dark ground and ends with a dark figure on a light ground. The other thing about this, it takes advantage of the smearing of light into its different spectral hues, and of course the difference in the position of the different, the red, green and the blue light, the further it goes out from the holographic plate. So I intentionally filled up the entire volume of space with small particles so that each of these particles, when they became further from the holographic plate, would actually become rainbows so that, you know, as they spread apart, they would blur to actually fill out the space. So here I'm saying we have a kind of a theatrical device at our disposal, which also, like many artists who love to champion things which are often thought of as a problem and something that needs to be fixed to make things more real. I mean, by the way, the reading of imagery is a completely different kind of operation than the reading of real things. And it's very rare that a holographic artist put forward their hologram as though it's a real thing. that holograms are images, and the knowledge of reading imagery, theatrical imagery, film imagery comes into play. This is the computer graphics, one single computer graphic frame from which that that other hologram was made that I showed you earlier. You also notice a high use of transparency. I tend to use a great deal of transparency in my work. Okay, here is, again, the use of the replay light. This is the computer graphics of pretty similar, pretty close to the last image for a portrait I made of art patron Anne Lewis. It was a commission by the Newcastle Region Art Gallery and supported by the Australia Council and also the Friends of Anne Lewis, who chipped in the money. And this is the computer graphic pre-visualisation done by Graham Olson, who I work with on many projects. And the way in which I composed this hologram was as three stencils for the red, the green and the blue master hologram. The background eventually became red and blue rather than red and green, so it only had one colour in it. And each of the glasses lenses were made by superimposing just two colours, and then, of course, the white had all three colours. And I did this in order to generate an enormous amount of energy around the eyes to make the portrait really live. So you can see that the hologram actually looks a hell of a lot more exciting than the computer graphics for the hologram. And John Perry, I say this, John Perry was just so fantastic in making this hologram, but I must say that I intentionally made him move the stencils and deregister them on purpose. He was quite horrified when I told him that I wanted to have the effect of the corona of colours all around the edges. So obviously the red and the blue master were shot to match, otherwise the lines in the background wouldn't have matched up. But the green master was offset and slightly sized incorrectly so that there would be a lot of energy and a lot of exciting colours being mixed as the viewer moved around in the space, so that the kind of dynamic of movement, no matter what it was, excuse me, generated something new and exciting. And of course, it's a big fat joke on anaglyphic imagery, because of course a hologram doesn't have to be anaglyphic, but yes, it is a stereogram. The first stage is computer graphics and the second stage is analog. So these images show some of the beautiful colours that are mixed by having this superimposition, which kind of reminds one of anaglyphic imagery. This optically formed fringe digital hologram was made by Zebra Imaging. And rather than using a soft kind of dissolve to incorporate three images, this had the it was a three-channel hologram with very strong and severe wipes, because this was a research hologram designed to research if it was possible to make in three dimensions the way in which Leonardo da Vinci, Giotto and Masaccio used darkness in their compositions. Now, thanks to using Maya for the graphics for this, I was able to actually make a negative light and for the first time actually making shine, I can't think of a better word, but Leonardo da Vinci had this idea that light, that darkness was like light, that you could shine it onto things, and it was in his writing. So thanks to Maya's programming, I could make a negative light and shine it onto this figure so that the figure kind of disintegrated in a kind of darkness. And for this, the Giotto image, Giotto had this kind of way of modelling the figure, now often known as modelling tone, where anything which is perpendicular to the picture plane is the lightest, and as the angle of the three-dimensional form turns around, it becomes darker. So in order to make that true for every viewer, rather than the image changing to look at the viewer like the eyes of the figure moving, the camera was organised so that the light on the figure emanated from the capture camera, no matter where the viewer's eyes were. So from up high or down low, wherever you looked at the hologram, it seemed as though the light was coming from you. So this places the viewer in a very unique uniquely holographic and digital hologram situation, and that is it constructed the viewer as though they were a light. Rather than looking at something and saying, oh, aren't they beautiful, aren't they a light, it actually made the viewer realize that in fact they were illuminating the hologram, that they were in fact a light. And this is really the kind of this is the kind of effect that I think Giotto was trying to get at with his frescoes. Now here's another kind of a thing, completely different. 5 minutes? Yep, I can do it in five, no worries. This is a recent work done at the Holo Center, and it's called A Hologram for Mr. Spielberg. And this is part of the reappropriation of holographic, icons and legends. And I decided, much like the Joseph Beuys hat idea and the Magritte hat idea, that after Van Gogh's idea of doing a hologram as a portrait of someone as a chair. So this was done at the Holo Center, and I wanted to actually record a genuine holographic special effect, the pseudoscopic image. This is what I wanted to do, okay? I wanted to, first of all, so this is H1, to make a hologram upside down of a director's chair, to get the H1 and to play it back on this thing. So this funny device made out of all of these crazy, the bottoms of those Mirage toys, which are marketed as holograms. So I got a whole, 50 of them from the factory, stuck them onto this parabola. And what I was going to do, see the developing tray up there, had a deionizer to make a smoke machine. And what I wanted to do was put the hologram on the floor and project the pseudoscopic image into the smoke in the space and have the director's chair, a pseudoscopic image of the director's chair floating in smoke reflected by all of the parabolic mirrors, okay? Well, as we well know, what you want to do and what you wind up doing can be quite a different thing. So with a little help from my friends, especially Anna Maria, I have to thank the crew, the wonderful, wonderful crew. All of them pitched in and helped me and said, well, come on, Paula, we got to figure out what we can do. So we went back and hung the chair up the right way within this structure, and then remade the hologram, called a hologram for Mr. Spielberg, because it actually is a real hologram. And but then I was thinking about this whole kind of culture of the making of. So in other words, when you get a DVD movie, you always get another DVD that shows you how this great genius actually made this fantastic film. And I thought that really fitted in with Steven Spielberg. And Martina so beautifully mounted the little hologram, because we made a test hologram with a piece of foam board where the pseudoscopic image was meant to be, to see if it was the fact that the smoke wasn't big enough or if the idea wasn't ever going to work. And sure enough, there was the pseudoscopic image on the piece of foam board. So it would have worked if I could have got enough smoke, but we couldn't have that sort of thick theatrical smoke because it would have wrecked the laser. So I decided to make a separate little work called The Director's Cut, Scene 1 and Scene 2. And so this separate work called The Director's Cut, the first cut is, of course, the chair upside down hologram that I made. And the second one is a little tiny hologram of the entire scene with all of these strange Mirage toys with the pseudoscopic image. And so that kind of feeds into what people understand about movies and the making of, and kind of also shows the holographic process is one of, there's a photo just in one color of the finished hologram with the smallest amount of pathetic smoke ever. And very finally, something I'm working on at the moment, which I think a lot of artists will like once I get it right, is I've been working with a fantastically brilliant team of people who are writing software to enable it to be possible to draw three-dimensionally using tactile feedback, using this haptic device known as a Phantom, which was developed at MIT. It's commercially available. And so you can draw something, and then because you can save it as an OBJ file, or you can save it as a JPEG file, you can save it in any format, but because you can save it as an OBJ file, you can actually play it out, hopefully in the future, as holographic video, which is made from the computation of the hologram, and eventually you'll be able to draw in real time. And seeing as one of the major problems, and by the way, I think that it only makes sense to have the image projected in front of the screen rather than straddling. That's my own personal opinion, although I'm doing some tests at the moment, excuse me, of the placement of imagery in different parts. So I this sphere and this cone of light is uncharacteristically formal. This is just a screen grab. But the thing around it, the menu, is completely fictitious and made up strictly to guide the viewer psychologically to read the holographic space of holographic video. And I'll just explain that this is one of the things, like in the 15th century, people knew about horses and dancing. Well, everyone knows about computer screens. Everyone knows about movies. Everyone knows what a cut is, what a dissolve is. Everyone knows what a star is. Everyone knows. So this computer menu has text up the top. It has icons down the bottom, which are placed exactly at zero position on the Z-axis so that it locates and makes sense of the holographic screen. But these kind of funny telephone pole things going down the sides are derived from road signs and arrows which keep the viewer's eyes in. And there's a new version of that which has the double posts. But I'm just ending on this slide of Venice. And it's very funny that after I designed this menu and the second design was going to have double barber's poles, one behind one another, so that when you got both posts behind one another, you were looking front onto the image as a kind of locator. As I was going along the Grand Canal in Venice from the Biennale, I actually saw that this has been for centuries the way in which they use the location of space for gondolas to arrive at the wharf and to kind of be in the right place. So I end on this note that really, out there in the real world, in everyday life, are all kinds of visual clues which will make it easier for people to understand holograms, and I hope these ones I presented can be helpful. Thank you. 谢谢.